Aloha, everyone, and welcome to Out of the Doldrums. I'm Irmina van Dyken, MD. Today, we're diving deep into the biochemistry and physiology of nitric oxide, a molecule imperative to our vascular health, cognitive function, and so much more. Stick with me as we uncover 7 science-backed ways to boost nitric oxide levels in our body. Number 1, nasal breathing. Our nose is not just an organ for smelling, it's a sophisticated piece of biological machinery. Deep within the paranasal sinuses, specialized cells produce nitric oxide. When we breathe through our noses, we actively channel this nitric oxide into our lungs. As you take in a deep nasal breath, the nitric oxide travels from your sinuses to the lungs. Here, it increases the lungs' oxygen uptake by improving blood flow. It does this by expanding tiny air sacs in the lungs called alveoli and dilating the surrounding blood vessels. This allows for a more efficient exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide, enriching our bodies with life-sustaining oxygen. Nitric oxide also acts as a bronchodilator and an antimicrobial agent. And lastly, by dilating blood vessels, nitric oxide helps regulate blood pressure. You might be wondering, what happens when we mouth breathe? Well, mouth breathing bypasses the nitric oxide-rich environment of our nasal passages. As a result, we miss out on the added oxygenation and other benefits that come from the nitric oxide produced in the sinuses. Simply put, while we can obtain oxygen via mouth breathing, it's not as efficient or beneficial as nasal breathing. So just say no to mouth breathing. Number 2, humming. I did a whole video on this. It's linked below. Like we just discussed, our paranasal sinuses are nitric oxide factories. This region produces NO continually, and when we breathe through our nose, we transport this beneficial molecule straight to our lungs. Researchers have discovered that the act of humming amplifies the production and release of nitric oxide. How, you ask? Well, humming creates a resonating sound wave. This vibration increases airflow oscillation in the sinuses, leading to a surge in nitric oxide release. In fact, a 2002 study published in the American Journal of Respiratory and Critical Care Medicine found that the airflow oscillations caused by humming resulted in a 15-fold increase in nitric oxide release. More fascinatingly, not all hums are equal. Optimal frequencies lie between 100 to 200 hertz, with around 130 hertz seeming to be the sweet spot for maximizing NO release. For context, this frequency is somewhat akin to the pitch of a low, deep male voice. How long and how frequently do we need to hum to get the nitric oxide release? Well, specific durations haven't been universally recommended. A practical approach is to incorporate periods of humming into your daily routine. Dedicate, say, 5 minutes daily to focused humming, ensuring you're in the optimal frequency range. This will not only be a meditative exercise, but also one rich in physiological rewards. Number 3, exercise. Every time we exercise, our muscles require more oxygen. To meet this demand, blood flow must increase. The inner lining of our blood vessels, known as the endothelium, becomes activated during exercise. These endothelial cells produce nitric oxide in response to the mechanical forces exerted by the increased blood flow. Now, let's get a little bit more technical. When you exercise, the shear stress, that's the frictional force of blood, activates an enzyme called endothelial nitric oxide synthase, or ENOS for short. ENOS facilitates the conversion of an amino acid called L-arginine into our star molecule, nitric oxide. So what happens when we produce nitric oxide while exercising? Well, first we get vasodilation. NO signals the smooth muscles in our arteries to relax, leading to widening of the blood vessels, which allows more blood to flow and cater to the oxygen demands of our working muscles. Second, we get enhanced oxygen delivery. With vasodilation, more oxygen-rich blood reaches the muscles, ensuring they work efficiently and recover faster post-exercise. Third, we get increased nutrient delivery. It's not just about oxygen. Increased blood flow means faster delivery of essential nutrients to the muscles. This aids in repair and growth. Another thing to note is that these benefits are long-term. Consistent exercises does more than provide an immediate boost in nitric oxide. Over time, it enhances the endothelium's capacity to produce nitric oxide, even when you're at rest. This can contribute to improved vascular health and lower risks of cardiovascular diseases. Lastly, when it comes to nitric oxide production, not all exercises are created equal. While almost all forms of exercise stimulate nitric oxide production, aerobic exercises like jogging, swimming, and cycling tend to have a more pronounced effect on NO release due to the sustained increase in blood flow. Resistance training also generates nitric oxide, especially during high-intensity sets. Number 4, eating nitrate-rich foods. Our diet plays a pivotal role in nitric oxide production. Consuming nitrate-rich foods helps boost nitric oxide. When we consume vegetables like beetroot or spinach, our body converts the nitrates to nitrites thanks to the oral bacteria in our mouth. Once in our stomach, nitrites can be further converted to nitric oxide. This pathway highlights the importance of dietary nitrates in cardiovascular health. The journey of a dietary nitrate to nitric oxide is a fascinating one. Foods like spinach, arugula, beets, and celery are teeming with nitrates. But here's the kicker. Our bodies don't directly convert these nitrates to nitric oxide. Instead, it's a multi-step process involving bacteria and multiple organs. Let's take a quick moment to review that nitrate-nitrite-nitric oxide pathway. There's 4 main steps. So step 1, dietary intake. When you consume nitrate-rich foods, these nitrates are absorbed into the bloodstream through the small intestine. Step 2, salivary concentration. A significant portion of these nitrates get concentrated in the salivary glands, and then they're secreted into the mouth. Step 3, the oral microbiome. The oral cavity houses specific bacteria that reduce these nitrates to another compound called nitrites. Step 4, swallowing and conversion. Once swallowed, these nitrites, under certain conditions, especially in conditions of low oxygen, like during intense exercise, can be reduced to form nitric oxide. Moreover, the stomach's acidic environment also converts nitrites to nitric oxide. So for the record, top food sources of nitrates are beets, spinach, arugula, celery, and lettuce. With dietary nitrates, it's essential to maintain balance. Excess nitrate intake, especially from sources like processed meats, can have health risks. These nitrates often come with other compounds, such as amines, which can form nitrosoamines, some of which are carcinogenic. Thus, it's always recommended to get nitrates from natural vegetable sources. Number 5, photobiomodulation. Ever heard of photobiomodulation, or PBM for short? At its core, photobiomodulation, often referred to as low-level laser therapy or red light therapy, involves using specific wavelengths of light to trigger biological reactions within cells. This isn't your everyday light. PBM specifically uses red and near-infrared light, which have unique penetration properties and physiological effects. So, how does shining light on our skin or our tissues influence this tiny molecule nitric oxide? The science revolves around cellular structures called cytochromes, present in our mitochondria, which are the powerhouse of the cell. Cytochromes, especially cytochrome C oxidase, play a pivotal role in cellular energy production. Nitric oxide, under certain conditions, can bind to these cytochromes, inhibiting their function and thus reducing cellular energy production. Then you get a sad, powerless mitochondria. PBM, particularly at wavelengths around 660 nanometers, which is red, and 850 nanometers, which is near infrared, can displace the nitric oxide from these cytochromes, restoring mitochondrial function. So we have happy mitochondria. With NO released from the cytochromes, it causes vasodilation, or the widening of blood vessels. This effect improves blood flow, bringing more oxygen and nutrients to the treated area. Number 6, supplementing with L-arginine and citrulline. L-arginine is an amino acid, the building blocks of proteins. It plays a crucial role in the synthesis of nitric oxide. Here's the exact mechanism. Step 1, endothelial cells. Our blood vessels lining, known as the endothelium, contains cells that produce an enzyme called endothelial nitric oxide synthase, ENOS for short. Remember, we talked about it a little bit ago. Step two, ENOS catalyzes the conversion of L-arginine to nitric oxide and L-citrulline. Step three, L-citrulline, initially produced as a byproduct in the L-arginine to nitric oxide conversion, doesn't just sit idle. The kidneys transform L-citrulline into L-arginine, which can then re-enter the nitric oxide production cycle. Here's a cool fact. Supplementing with citrulline can sometimes be more effective at increasing L-arginine levels in the body than supplementing with L-arginine itself. This is because L-arginine can be metabolized in the liver before reaching the bloodstream, whereas citrulline bypasses this metabolism and is converted to L-arginine in the kidneys, ensuring a more significant boost to circulating L-arginine. Step 7, optimizing the oral microbiome. Our mouths are teeming with a diverse community of bacteria, fungi, and viruses, collectively called the oral microbiome. While some of these microbes can cause disease, hello cavities, many are crucial for maintaining oral health. Beneficial bacteria in our mouths play a pivotal role in converting dietary nitrates to nitrites, the precursor to nitric oxide. In essence, our oral microbiome acts as a bioreactor, aiding in the production of a molecule crucial for our well-being. Overusing antiseptic mouthwash can disrupt this bacterial balance, hindering nitric oxide production. To optimize the enterosalivary circuit, we need these bacteria intact. Check out the video I made all about this process. It's linked down below. And there you have it, 7 ways, grounded in science, to elevate your nitric oxide levels. For a molecule so tiny, its impact on our health is profound. If you appreciated this deep dive into the science of nitric oxide, please give this video a thumbs up. And what did I miss? What other ways can we increase nitric oxide? If you want to show us some real support, subscribe. We love hearing from you, so please share your thoughts on the video and suggestions for future videos below. Thanks for joining us. Until next time, stay safe, cherish your health, and as always, aloha.